Hi everyone. Great. My name is Donna Rapaccioli, and I have the privilege of serving as the Dean of the Gabelli School of Business at Fordham University. Welcome to our Centennial webinar series, and thank you everybody for joining. 2020 marks 100 years of purpose-driven business education at Fordham. And since our inception, we believed in the power of partnerships to inform and to lead change. So I'd like to thank two of our important partners, the CFA Society of New York, and especially the Museum of American Finance, who are co-sponsoring today's conversation with Bob Pisani, guided by Consuelo Mack. Thank you both for being with us today. To learn about other Centennial events, please take a look at our website, fordham.edu/Gabelli100. The lineup for speakers includes entrepreneurs, global executives, economists, and more. As we continue to analyze the dramatic downturn that COVID-19 health crisis brought to our global economies, we're looking for ways to anticipate what the future might look like as businesses and entire industries re-envision and reimagine themselves. These days are really important moments in history that will be studied by our students and by generations to come, which is why I'm so grateful to hear the perspective of Bob and Consuelo today. During today's webinar, please type your questions into the Q&A section near the bottom of your Zoom screen. Our speakers will be addressing as many as they can. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce David Cowan of the Museum of American Finance.
Thanks, Donna. As we continue the partnership between the museum and Gabelli, today's topic of a conversation, where are we? So apropos, we've just had Chairman Powell's testimony. We've got wild market gyrations. And who better to address this? Bob Pisani, of course, a regular, daily regular on CNBC since 1990. He has seen so many crises and has covered them from the front lines. Joined, of course, in conversation with Consuelo, who brings us wisdom from her show Wealth Track, now in its 16th season. Two things to know. They're longstanding friends since their paths crossed early on at CNBC in the 90s, as well as they're both great supporters of the museum. Consuelo's on our board of trustees, Bob, a longstanding member, as well as contributor to our magazine, Financial History. That magazine is digital, it's free, just go to our website and sign up. We do have a hard stop today at 12:40-ish, right around there. Well, I'll stay on for a few minutes maybe after that, but please, let's get going. It's my pleasure to turn it over to Consuelo.
Thank you so much, David. And history matters, and the Museum of American Finance plays a critical role in teaching all of us about the history of finance and how important it is to world growth and prosperity. So Bob Pisani, what a treat to be talking to you. This is so great. Thanks so much for taking time out of your incredibly busy schedule. And the hard out that David just mentioned at 12:40 is because you've got to go back to report on what's going on in Wall Street. So let's talk about one of the things that you are really interested in, and I am as well, is explain the disconnect between what's happening on Wall Street in general, this incredible rally we've had since March 23rd, and what's been happening in the economy, where the economy literally fell off the cliff.
Yeah, and first, thank you for having me, David, and Donna, and Annalise, and Consuelo, my old colleague. Consuelo and I were together over 20 years ago at CNBC, and we're still friends. I'm very proud of that. I think we have to be very sensitive about this topic because there is a little bit of a disconnect, and I can explain why, but that is not necessarily very intellectually satisfying. So people are hurting, and I think we as financial journalists need to be very sensitive to the fact that people are hurting and not just give a usual explanation. So usual explanation is, the stock market is a discounting mechanism for a future stream of earnings, usually 6 months to a year out. So the markets aren't concerned about how you are feeling right now. It's concerned about how you're feeling 6 months to a year from now. That is all true, but it somehow sounds not very satisfying emotionally to somebody who's really hurting. I can get a little more specific. I can say, you see, right now, this epidemic is accelerating certain technological trends that are benefiting companies that are really big in the stock market. So for example, Microsoft, Facebook, Google/Alphabet, anything else in that category, Apple. These are all
things
stay at home. mentality. So that is a major factor that's accelerating technological trends that have already been important. I think, Consuelo, to answer it simply, the way I look at the world is I put things in boxes and it makes it easier to explain complicated things. So there's four or five things that are moving the market right now, very short term. The first and most important is, how is the reopening story going? Is it going well or is it not going well? You saw today, they're announcing they're closing some schools in Beijing. Well, that's a problem for the reopening story in the United States. We haven't been doing that yet, closing again, but that's a bit of a warning. The second thing is the stimulus. Is there more coming from the Federal Reserve and the Congress, or is there less coming? And Jay Powell's testifying, and he basically said, we'll do whatever we need to do. The third story is treatment and vaccines. The good news or bad news on this front? And generally, this has been pretty good news. One of the reasons the market's holding up. The other is the whole trade war issue with China. Haven't heard a lot about that, but that's out there. And the final thing that moves the market is this. Is the market overvalued or undervalued? You saw last week, stock prices went up stupidly. Some of these airlines went up crazy numbers. Didn't make a lot of economic sense. People say, you know what? This doesn't make a lot of economic sense, but the market goes up. And at some point, it corrects a little bit. So if you think of everything in these little buckets about the market short term, you can understand. And when somebody says to you, hey, Bob, why is the market up or down today? You can refer to those particular buckets. Now, the long term, there's different issues that move the markets around earnings. We could talk about it if you want to. But the simple way to understand it is the market's moving on a few things right now. And that's what really is mattering to the market.
Let's talk about what the market's doing moving now, what is moving it now short term. And people are talking about a V-shaped recovery, but they're also talking about V for a vaccine. And so there is a body of thought out there that the market is responding to, that there's an end date to this pandemic, and what is going to enable a reopening, a full reopening, is a vaccine. How much is the Fed, how much is the market considering that we're going to get a vaccine much sooner than later? For instance, by September, when David Rosenberg was on WellTrack recently, and he said he feels that the market is baked into the market's rally is that we're going to get a vaccine, by the fall, which he thinks is highly unlikely. But you tell me, how dependent is this rally on a vaccine sooner rather than later?
I think I'm going to go against the grain. I think it's a little less than you think. Here's why. What the market really wants here is not necessarily cure-alls, but treatment modalities that reduce death rates and reduce, ameliorate symptoms of it. So let's assume that we don't get any vaccine at all into 2021. If you find treatment modalities that are successful in reducing death rates and ameliorating a lot of the problems, the market may be able to live with that. It's we're going to have 120,000 deaths right now. We may have 200,000 from COVID. That's a remarkable number. But think about this. There's 50,000 deaths a year almost from automobile accidents, tens of thousands from gunshots. It's amazing that we tolerate that kind of level of carnage, if the market's gotten used to it. Now, I'm not suggesting you never get used to anything like that for COVID, but if we can find a way to just dramatically reduce it, I think the market may find a way to live with that, even if by, November 2020, we don't necessarily have a vaccine. So I'm agreeing with your point. Amelioration of the problem is definitely part of the story. Those buckets I talked about, the four or five, vaccine and treatment, definitely part of the game. But there may be other ways that market could be satisfied other than just saying, okay, we have a miracle vaccine cure on November 1st. I'm not sure that's necessarily going to happen as quickly as people think. I'm much more optimistic about treatment. Look how successful we've had just keeping people out of hospitals or reducing death rates. We don't have any vaccine, but we are reducing the death rate. And I think it's treatment that's really going to be important.
Reopening, Bob, was one of your buckets. So, how quickly does the market react to, as you just said, the news from Beijing? Is that going to be a constant factor in whether the market rallies or declines?
Yes. Yeah, I mean, today, look what happened. Jay Powell is testifying, this is an hour ago or so, and a flash came across, Beijing closing all public schools because they've had an outbreak there. It's not clear how big the outbreak is. It started in a market. It's not clear what the cause is, frankly, of that. I'm not sure we'll ever know. But the one thing you know about the Chinese is they act very aggressively, very quickly. So it sounds like a pretty extreme thing to do, close all public schools, but that's the way they operate. So this plays into the reopening story. And one of the fears of the reopening story is that you would have to start closing down again parts of the United States. Now, we have had public officials, including Larry Kudlow, say, we're not going to do that. Now, it's not entirely in his hands. State officials could decide to do something if this renewed outbreaks. So it's just not entirely in the federal government's hands. I think the possibility of widespread shutdowns is kind of unlikely, unless it really kind of gets out of hand, because we've seen the economic effects of that. And so there are equations, there are calculations being made about the damage caused by the virus and the economic damage. This is sometimes difficult for people to handle emotionally. It certainly is difficult for me, but I understand why those kinds of calculations are being made. So the market watches things like that announcement from Beijing very carefully, and it plays into those who say, this is a risk for the markets. And for those of you who think the market's going up too fast, we agree with you. Here is a renewed risk, and we're telling you. So there's a constant debate going on about this.
Monetary and fiscal stimulus, Jay Powell testifying. I mean, you know, he is, needless to say, a market mover, as is Nancy Pelosi, as is President Trump, when these, you know, massive stimulus packages come through, both monetary stimulus and fiscal stimulus. How big a factor is that, and how big a factor is that going to be in the future?
Now, it's very difficult to quantify this. So you say to yourself, okay, the market is way off that low on March 23rd. And in fact, the S&P is only, what, 4% from the historic high on February 19th? That's pretty amazing. Think about this. So who's responsible for this? Is it the good news on the reopening? Is it because we're not in some trade war with China? Is it because the market is overvalued? I believe, and I can tell you, most market believes that the single greatest reason we have risen is the Federal Reserve is doing massive stimulus. I don't know if people really understand what's going on here. The Federal Reserve was created in 1913, essentially to be the lender of last resort. And it was created to stop all the bank runs. They were called panics in the 19th century, where banks failed and nobody was there to step in and people lost fortunes. So the Fed was created to provide a stable monetary supply and to monitor inflation and to do whatever it could to provide for maximum employment. So those are the two mandates, to watch inflation and provide for full employment and manage the money supplies, and they're the bank regulator. That's the definition of what the Federal Reserve essentially does. So the lender of last resort idea kind of morphed after the financial crisis. Suddenly they weren't just lenders, they were buyers of things like treasury bonds in very big ways that they never have been before. If you ask me what worries me about this, I'm not necessarily worried about the budget blowing up. I'm not necessarily worried about the deficit going up so much or the debt. I'm more concerned what's called the monetization of debt. It's a fancy word for printing money. And I don't think people fully understand this. You know, I like to do it very simply. I said, look, if you're XYZ Bank or a client of XYZ Bank and you want to buy you want to sell $100 million in U.S. bonds to the Federal Reserve, you go to the window, literally, and you say, here's $100 million in bonds. And they look, oh, yeah, this is $100 million. But there's not a little guy wearing a hat sitting across the teller table, $100 million, and he pushes it across the aisle to you. What happens is there's a man in the Federal Reserve and they push a button, electronically transfers money to the bank, and that bank puts the money in the account of the person selling the bonds. But there is no money transferred in most cases here. The Federal Reserve creates the money out of nothing, ex nihilo. This is a pretty darn neat trick. I mean, think about what that means, monetization of the debt. I always said, I wish we could get a picture of the guy pushing the button, because literally you push the button. There is no money that's actually involved. It's fiat currency. So
right.
In theory, of course, the big concern is this creates inflation. And under a classic definition, you know this, Consuelo, you're a student of this.
Friedman.
It's considered to be a monetary phenomenon where you've right. Essentially got an increase in the amount of money. And yet it hasn't happened. And this is why the Federal Reserve feels somewhat emboldened. They started doing this in 2008 on a much smaller scale, and everybody said, oh, this is the end of capitalism. It's going to destroy inflation, and the Fed's going to have a problem. And yet it didn't happen in that manner. It didn't, that the kind of inflation, and there's a lot of debate about why that hasn't happened.
Yes, exactly. So the money's got to be in circulation. And I just want to say that the Museum of American Finance did a big program on the centennial of the Fed at one point. And also, you know, that's what we learn about what you just talked about, Bob. Yeah. And its chairman, Dick Sylla, was on Wealth Track recently and just, you know, said that the stimulus is shocking and almost disturbing. He's a very understated economist. He wrote like the classic book on interest rates. So, you know, is anyone on Wall Street, is the market paying attention to the potential inflationary prospects from this massive monetary stimulus?
Yes, there are deficit hawks and there are inflation hawks.
The market at all? I mean, are we seeing
Let me tell you what they're concerned about.
Yeah.
Deficit hawks and inflation hawks have been somewhat muted by the fact that the blow up they anticipated in 2008 from the Fed doing this didn't really happen. So there's a lot of debate about why. Some argue that a lot of the liquidity, the money, found its way into the stock market and the bond market where it doesn't generate that inflation because you don't have goods that are out there. That's one possibility. Another is just technological change that created manufacturing efficiencies, aging of the U.S. population. So those are reasons why. There are also people who get very angry about this who say, I don't know what inflation you're looking for, but have you paid your healthcare bill? Mine's going up. Have you paid your kids' college bill? Mine was going up. And they're right. There are pockets of inflation in the United States for sure. What the Fed tends to concentrate on is on goods that are out there. And that's where I think it's been a little more subdued. You want to know about what the market thinks. I think putting aside the inflation debate, the market's concerned about two things. The market's concerned that this kind of intervention, if you want to call it that, creates distortions in the market. I mean, what happens when the Federal Reserve becomes one of the biggest buyers of bonds in the world? What happens when the Japanese central bank essentially owns almost all the bonds and owns a good part of the exchange traded funds that are equity exchange traded funds in Japan? Doesn't that create a distortion in the market? I think it does.
Doesn't it? Right.
Significant. So that's one concern. The other concern that players have is that it creates zombie markets. It creates zombie companies too. I have a friend of mine who's a financial advisor, and he said, you know what worries about the Fed? I'll give you, there's an analogy. Think of the bull market, just 11 years old, just ended, but it's 11 years old, as an aging zebra out in the wild. Now, an aging zebra can't run as fast as it used to because it's getting old and it knows it. And all of a sudden there's a lion that comes around the corner. The lion is the coronavirus. And now the zebra is really worried because it's in trouble. It's not fast anymore. It can't outrun the lion. The Federal Reserve comes around and puts a fence around the lion. And now the lion can't get at the zebra. This is a metaphor. So the point is that this is the zombie market story. The point is that an aging bull market would have died gracefully. And here the Federal Reserve is really trying to do something that's rather dramatic. I personally am in favor of the Fed's intervention. I think that the 2008 crisis taught them that they can do this. And they can do this successfully. They're doing on a much higher level right now. But I'll go along with anyone who acknowledges that there's risks out there for creating zombie markets and for creating distortions. And I agree with those concerns.
And they certainly, the Fed doesn't seem to be able to exit gracefully. And, how dependent is the market, the Fed put, for instance,
right.
that if the market starts to decline, the Fed's going to rescue you. So that's baked into the market right now too, right?
Right, yes. The single most important factor in keeping the market up is the Fed put. There is a Fed put. There is a floor under the market. Market participants believe that. Look, if you go back to the March 23rd lows, the vast majority of people that are invested in the market, that are active investors, believe the Fed will get even more aggressive. And people used to say before this happened, oh, the Fed's out of bullets. What can they do? They've been buying a whole bunch of treasury bonds. You know what it turns out? The Fed wasn't even close to being out of bullets. In fact, you can't even imagine what the Federal Reserve is going to be doing next. If things really completely fell apart again, they'll get even more creative. And I get this asked this all the time. Could the Fed buy stocks? I mean,
they can buy high yield ETFs. That's on their.
They never could before. Right. When we announced this in March, I mean, we have very smart people watching CNBC. I got emails from people saying, hey, Bob, you know, they can't do this. They can't go out and buy corporate bonds. They cited Section 14 of the Federal Reserve Act. There actually is a Section 14. It deals with the open market thing. There's nothing in there that says, this says, here's what the Federal Reserve can do and what they can buy. And it doesn't say corporate bonds. And what they did was a brilliant workaround. They have certain emergency powers under Section 13 that says, we can act to stabilize things. So what they did was they created these special purpose vehicles, and essentially they had the Treasury Department buying them. So the Federal Reserve, this is a brilliant trick. The Federal Reserve essentially became the banker to the Treasury Department with these special purpose vehicles that actually ends up buying these. This is I don't say if it's an end run around the Federal Reserve Act, but it's certainly very creative use of the Federal Reserve Act, because there ain't nothing in there that says you can buy corporate bonds or, as you said, high yield ETFs or anything like that. So my answer, people say, could the Fed ever buy stocks, is, well, yes, they certainly could. My point is the Fed has proven to be so creative now, post-2008, that I wouldn't put it past them in a real crisis. So the Fed isn't anywhere close to being run out of bullets.
You know, another anomaly in the markets right now is if you look at the fund flows, for instance, throughout, you know, the record rally, stock market rally, which, as you just said, is, you know, ended, but then, gee, we seem to be in a new rally or a continuation or a bear market rally, whatever you want to call it. But the flow of funds, there have been withdrawals from equities, and there have been huge inflows into bonds. I mean, in the last, since the market low, for instance, I think it was there were inflows into equities of $12 billion, but there were inflows into bonds of $65 billion. And it's so, you know, who's doing the buying?
Yeah. First, fund flows is a very tricky subject. I have been watching these for 20 years.
Right.
The advent of ETFs, it gets very, very tricky. You have to look at short-term versus long-term. These vehicles are used by very active traders to get in and out. And depending on when you pick a date, weekly or monthly or quarterly, you can see flows that it's just momentum trading, frankly. Mm-hmm. So you have to be a little careful. Long-term, though, I agree. It has been an amazing phenomenon, the strength of the flows in bonds.
Yes.
I can explain this several ways. Number one, when volatility goes up, you get natural flows into this as protection. But remember, too, the U.S. population is aging. And they are quite aware, those of us who are invested in stocks and bonds, of the old 60-40 rule, which I think is outdated, but a lot of people still do it. So as the U.S. population is aging more, and that's where a lot of the money is, you get more flows into bonds. The third is, remember the international competition. Japan is zero at a 10-year. Germany is minus 0.3%. I mean, think how stupid that is. That's insane. You can't explain that to anyone. I'm going to give the government 10 years, and I'm losing money on that. So the demand, think of the demand by a Japanese pension fund. Sounds fantastic, 0.7% for a U.S. 10. They're propping it up. The foreign buyers are a major reason why our bond market has been so strong for a long time, because on a relative basis, it's an absolute value. What would you rather have, 0.7% 10-year U.S. or flat to minus 0.2% Japanese 10 years? So that's readily understandable, the strength of the bond market, even at 0.7%.
Bob, you mentioned valuations as one of your buckets as well. So give us your take on the valuation levels of the market right now.
Yeah, so
this equity market.
The way, there's crude ways to look at valuations. And the way I look at it is, what drives stocks long-term, not short-term, not the coronavirus story, you know, and the reopening story. There's four things that drive stocks long-term over many, many years. The first thing is earnings. Are earnings growing or are they not growing? Think of that bucket.
And the answer to that is like not. Right
now, no. Right now, they're continuing to decline. Okay. Again, I look at forward earnings, not backward, not current, forward. I'm talking about 1 year from now, for Q3, Q4, Q1, Q2. That's how you look at it, forward earnings. Number two, dividends. Are they growing or not? They are not. In fact, many companies have been shrinking their dividends. So watch the bank stocks. I think you're going to see them, some of them shrinking their dividends.
And they're under pressure, basically, right. And, from the government as well.
People don't understand the value of dividends.
Popular to pay out.
That's right. 2% on the S&P 500. Again, this is the beauty of compounded interest. Look at the S&P on a price basis for 50 years, and then look at the S&P with dividends reinvested, what your returns are. And Consuelo, you know this, it's a huge difference. So dividends—
Like 40% of returns come from reinvesting dividends.
They can be 30 to 40% of total stock market returns over many, I'm talking decades now, okay? So there, number one, earnings, are they growing or not? Right now, they're not. Dividends, are they growing or not? Right now, they're not. The market multiple, what we call the PE ratio, is that growing? Yes, that's growing for sure. Forward, what does that mean? It means the market is anticipating the economy to get better and earnings are going to improve somewhere down the road. It's a hope that's out there, but that's all it is. The final thing, the fourth thing, and I think this is very important, is liquidity. How much money is there available to actually buy stocks and bonds? Is it shrinking or is it increasing? And the Fed's been increasing the monetary supply. So a lot of people have argued the main reason markets held up so well in the last decade has been because the Federal Reserve has been making the supply of money available, and a lot of that supply has been going into the stock market. Okay, so where are we right now? Earnings, they're still going down. They need to start going up. 40% of the S&P 500 has withdrawn earnings guidance this year. We don't have a clue what they're doing. By the way, they don't either. They need to start changing that, or the stock market rally is looking a little suspect. If we go on 3 months from now and nobody said a darn thing and earnings keep coming down, something's wrong. Dividends, got to have more stability there too. The market multiple, if the earnings go up, market multiple will come down a little, that's good. And the liquidity. So my point right now is the only thing that's really going up is the market multiple and hopes that the global economy is going to be better and hopes that earnings are going to get better. And you can only go so far on hope.
So we've got a couple of minutes before we go to questions from our audience, Bob. There's another phenomenon happening as well, and some people call it financial engineering. The fact is that the stock buybacks for years now have been at record amounts. That has shrunk the supply of shares out there, which means that the earnings look better than they actually would had there been the same number of shares. So that has also been propping up the market, right? And stock buybacks are, again, politically, they are incorrect right now. That there's a pressure if for anyone getting grants from the government is to that they're going to look very closely, Congress is, on what their stock buyback program is. So talk about how important that's been to the market rally.
Yes, it's been important, but don't exaggerate it too much. So if you really look at who's doing the buybacks, there's really about 20 companies that do most of the buybacks. Microsoft, Apple is the biggest one of all. You know, companies like Adobe too. But it's actually not as big as you think. But with that said, even those small companies certainly make a difference. And you're right. Buybacks are financial engineering. I don't know why people deny it. Seems that way to me. You hit it right. If all other numbers are the same, increasing the amount of stock that is bought back improves the earnings outlook without doing anything organic or fundamental. And that's financial engineering to me. The question is not whether it's financial engineering, it's whether it's the right thing to do. So you can throw the money into dividends if you want, excess cash into dividends. Companies don't like that because dividends get sticky. And so it's hard. If you would just increase the dividends rather than do a buyback, buybacks are done one time. You can just not decide to do it again or withhold it. So the company has a lot of discretion with buybacks they don't have with dividends necessarily. So there's one reason the buybacks work. But the bigger question is, what happened to investing in companies? Why don't we take our excess cash flow and do more capital investment? And I think that you'll find, this is what disturbs me, the cynical answer is corporate America has decided for a while that it's better to put excess cash into dividends or buybacks than into expanding the businesses.
This, right. Wall Street is more important than Main Street.
This can be either because
investing and expansion and job creation. I mean, that is what the critics of Wall Street say, and the critics of corporate America say. I'm not saying it, but that's what the critics are.
This can be for one of two reasons. Why are they doing this? So one is that one is the corporate greed story. So you can look at how do CEOs get paid? They get paid a salary, but usually a significant amount, it's a bonus in the form of stock price appreciation.
Right. And how the stock does is how they get, it's one of their criteria for judging how well they're doing. Right.
So in a certain cynical way, buybacks are, if you believe buybacks can help boost earnings that boost stocks indirectly, then that makes some sense. However, there's another reason here. If you really talk to a lot of people, some of them will say, you know, we don't see that many opportunities. So I don't know, I make auto parts. And for me to build a new auto part assembly plant doesn't make a lot of sense because the capacity isn't there to handle that. I'm in a business that's not necessarily growing that much, but I'm still making a profit. So what do you want me to do with the money? If I can build an auto parts manufacturing facility, but it's not going to make any money. So I'm sort of stuck by the parameters of the business that I'm in. Now, it would help if we had a more expanding economy, there were more babies out there, and the US economy was expanding faster with more population. But, you know, people I talk to say, these are the facts on the ground, Bob. I can explain how my industry works if you want, but it's better to put the money back in. So I can see both sides. There is a corporate greed story, but there's also limitations to what you can do in an economy that is only growing very, very moderately. We're not all going to turn around and build Harley plants.
Right. In fairness, the new economy companies, the Amazons, the Microsofts, they are investing heavily in AI, for instance, and other things. And Donna and David, do we have some questions that we can address to Bob from the field?
We do have plenty of questions. I'll take the first one, which is a bit of an amalgamation, that, you know, some of the things that we used to hear a lot about, we're not hearing much about now. And people are wondering if you have an opinion either on Bitcoin or also all the algo trading, the quant trading that's been, you know, going, that was so prevalent in the past. Is that still happening?
Yeah, I'll tell you what I think about Bitcoin. I understand why Bitcoin exists. I'm a blockchain fan, not a Bitcoin fan. Okay. Bitcoin is a digital currency that is tied to absolutely nothing. All of this talk that it was going to be an easy way to do payments is nonsense because the price fluctuates too much to make it, a medium of exchange. Now, I am interested in the concept of tethered coins that might be, say, tied to the US dollar, for example, and the ability to move around that kind of currency. But I'm not necessarily enamored with Bitcoin. Blockchain is an amazing technology. Blockchain answers the essential question, how do I know that I did something? How do I know that I just bought a piece of property? You know, we had these title deeds and these title insurance companies. Well, that's an interesting little game that people play. There's an intermediary that gets between me and knowing that I actually bought the property. How do I know I just bought 100 shares of IBM? Well, we have brokerage firms that do this and we have clearing houses that guarantee, oh, yep, you did buy it, Bob, I guarantee you do. So there's intermediaries to get in between all this. How do I know I just sent $1,000 to my relatives in Italy? Well, there are banks, in fact, there's about 15 of them that control the whole business in the world, and they charge you even if you go to your local bank because they'll charge the local bank and they'll charge you. So there's intermediaries. Blockchain can solve all of these problems. Blockchain could set up a way for me to transfer real estate, to transfer money, to buy stocks all at once. It's an amazing, truly revolutionary, transformative technology on the level of the internet. And that's why I believe in it. So I think everyone should figure out how do we accelerate that? And I'm a little disappointed I don't hear a lot about that in this COVID environment, because we hear about how we're accelerating other technologies like video conferencing, here it goes, like work from home. Other technologies have been around for a long time, are really getting a push. I don't hear as much about it in blockchain. I'd like to hear more. What was the second part of the question?
Also, great place to invest as well to try to figure that out. But that is not your job, Bob. So
yeah,
an investment opportunity will be there.
Yeah, the second one had to do with quant trading algorithm. How much of that is going on in your opinion right now?
Right. So think of it this way. How do you buy stocks and sell stocks? What do you use? I mean, other than throwing darts at a board, you can do that. It might be just as good long term. But there's several different methodologies. The one we use and most of us associate with stock trading is number one, technical analysis, where you're essentially looking at price patterns. But the one most commonly used is fundamental analysis, where you're looking at macroeconomics, movement of the US economy, movement of supply and demand, and then supply and demand for the company's individual goods and services. But there is a third way of trading stocks, which came to be known as quantitative analysis. In quantitative analysis, they don't care about any of that stuff. If you talk to a true quant, they're all mathematicians, they'll look at you and say, let me get this straight, Bob. You buy stocks based on what you think the GDP is going to do? You really think there's a correlation? Quants are not interested in anything other than finding correlations between numbers. So if, for example, somebody discovered a correlation between the corn supply in Nebraska and the S&P 500, and they actually felt it was statistically valid, you could set up a program to trade the corn supply versus the S&P 500. Now you say to yourself, well, why is the corn supply related to the S&P 500? You know what true quant would say? How do I know?
Right.
There's a relationship that's statistically valid. So that's what quantitative analysis does. These guys look for connections between data sets that don't necessarily look connected. Part of the problem with this is if everybody else finds out about it, you're done, because the trade doesn't work if everybody does the same thing. So the returns diminish very, very quickly. It's a perfectly valid way of looking at the world. It leads to a lot of weird stuff, though, stuff that happens that you don't necessarily understand. Sometimes they don't necessarily understand what it is. But, I mean, think about it. If you could find a relationship between something that you didn't see necessarily was connected, and somehow, for reasons you couldn't even understand, it turned out to be statistically valid, you know, wouldn't you trade? I don't know if that's a satisfying answer, David, but that's...
But I've got to follow up on that, because, you know, a lot of people think that Wall Street basically is rigged against the little guys, that fundamentals don't matter, that it's completely controlled by the algorithmic trading, which I can never pronounce. So what do you think? You've seen the you know, you've been in the markets since the 1990s.
Let me tell you. Yeah. Look, this is the entire history of the buy side has been complaining since the 1860s about stuff they don't understand, okay? So think of the history and the evolution of trading. The modern stock market, the New York Stock Exchange, in its modern form only goes back to the 1860s. Prior to that, they actually had individual auctions. One stood up and said, okay, XYZ Railroad, they're trading, and you just do it. And then eventually specialists developed. They developed post, the stock exchange developed, and they had things like the telegraph, and that created all sorts of people who were complaining about people getting advantages by telegraphing things ahead of people and not, you know, getting a competitive advantage. Then we had boats that were faster. Then we had the telephone. Then we had pneumatic tubes that were faster. There have been complaints all throughout that technology has given unfair advantages to certain people. So in the late 1970s, we started getting more computerized forms of trading. NASDAQ was created
specifically. So Bob, I'm the producer in your ear. You've got like your heart out is almost here. So do fundamentals still matter? Can individuals make it on Wall Street?
Look, I believe that the fundamentals always matter. And I believe that fundamentals are what drives the market the most. And that, anyone who is worried out there, oh, there's some dark, mysterious forces that are controlling the stock market, I don't understand. Stop doing that. Stop. Be a long-term investor. Think about where you want to be. If you're 35 years old, you should not worry about what happened to the stock market today. You should be worried about investing in a consistent daily basis. Do you know, people ask me what the stock market's doing all the time. Do you know no one ever asked me, what am I doing? Isn't that amazing? I find that incredible. I can't own individual stocks or bonds, but I can own, mutual funds and ETFs. And I'm a boring Jack Bogle Vanguard type disciple. I do nothing. I don't trade at all, nothing. But I'm a boring, consistent investor. I have found that out 25 years ago when I started hanging out with Jack Bogle, but that was the most consistent way. And yes, I do it because I believe the fundamentals matter. I believe in the United States economy. I believe in the United States. And it's fun to have a debate about what quants do and how weird they are. But believe me, in the long run, even quants would say the direction of the economy matters a lot and policy choices matter. And
I'm with you there, Bob Pisani. And you know, you might be a Jack Bogle type of investor, but you sure make the markets a lot of fun to listen to and participate in. So, and I know you have to go back to work and cover the markets for CNBC. So thanks, Bob.
Thank you very much, Consuelo. And for those of you who are not members of the Museum of American Financial History, please become a member. It is surprising and depressing, frankly, about how many people don't understand anything about history. We want to advocate for more education in public schools, for a one curriculum, one course on finance in
high
schools. One course that says, what's a bond, what's a stock, what does the Federal Reserve do? And we want to continue to have the Museum of American Finance out there educating the public.
And the benefits of capitalism, free markets, and a rule of law. David, Donna.
Thanks for shedding on those mysterious dark forces some light for us today. We're sincerely appreciative, Bob, Consuelo. We're sorry we had so many questions. We just didn't get to them. You guys are very popular, so it was great. Thank you to Fordham, as always, to Dean, Donna, and the entire team there. We've got a lot of events. Check out our website, Fordham's website, to sign up for, including Nobel laureate Robert Shiller in a couple of weeks. It's been great. Thanks again, Consuelo and Bob. See you guys soon.
Thank you, David.
Thank you. Thanks, Bob.
Thank you, Consuelo.
Thanks very much. Bye.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks, Donna.
Take care.